Good morning, everyone. I'd like to thank everyone who has tuned in today. So I'm going to go ahead and open us with prayer this morning. So if we could all please join our hearts. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it is in his blood and through his name that we boldly come before your throne this day. We thank you for this day that you've made. And we thank you knowing that as long as we keep our hearts and eyes focused on you and hand in hand with you, that no matter what comes our way, that you will see us through it. And Lord, this day our hearts are heavy for this nation and everything that is going on. Lord, we know so many people have suffered in so many ways, a type of suffering, Lord, that we haven't seen in a very long time. But we know that your grace and your mercy and your presence is always around us and about us and in us. So may we be that spiritual comfort to everyone. And we lift up this nation, Lord, and we lift up all those who are going through suffering and hard times of the lost of loved ones. And those who are in the hospital for whatever reason, and they're in there alone because no one else can come in to see them. We ask your spirit be mightily upon them. So we pray and ask that come, Lord Jesus, come, and that your spirit be mightily upon us this day, and open our spiritual hearts and minds to receive what it is that you've placed upon us to receive, and let your spirit be mightily upon me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'd like to thank everyone for tuning in today. So I'm doing a sermonette today, and I've been going back and forth on trying to figure out what to do a talk on. As we know, you just turn on the TV or radio, and we can pretty much just pick any subject out of the hat, and it'll be a good topic. But I wanted to go ahead and, you know, figure out a good talk that's really from my heart. So the title I have is, Where Do We Go From Here? Seeing how 2020 is in the rearview mirror, but let us not forget, objects in the mirror are closer than they appear. The events of 2020 are still with us, and will be for a while. So as we listen to the radio, and we watch the news, and we look around, we talk to friends and loved ones, we know very well, because we've been going through it, that COVID-19 has changed everything. Mask wearing is now a part of our everyday living. Many lives have been claimed by COVID-19 worldwide. But even with all these changes, this is not something that has come up that God has not known about. God has known that this is coming, and he is always prepared and ready for things like this. And he gives us his spirit. But we have to be tapping into that spirit and asking him to help us with everything that is changing around us. We go places and you can't even walk into a store anymore without it requiring that you wear a mask. Many people are getting mask wary, if you might say. But this is part of life, and we need to go ahead and we need to do our part to make sure that we follow the guidelines that have been put down. And more importantly, we are considerate and our love for our brethren. Now, our brethren does not just mean those that we go to church with. Our brethren means everyone around us. Or shall I say, love thy neighbor, as the Lord says. So wearing a mask is something that we do to protect those around us. And that is now part of life. And we should be doing that. With the many lives that have been claimed worldwide because of this, we find ourselves asking and praying, Lord, what is going on? What is happening? Faye and I have friends and family who have experienced COVID. Some of them have tested positive, have had no symptoms. Others have tested positive and had mild symptoms. Others have tested negative, still had symptoms. And others have had severe symptoms. And yet, we have friends and family who have told us of loved ones that have died because of COVID-19. So, This is very, very real, and it is happening all around us. But so is the presence of the Lord very real, and all around us. We must keep our focus on Him. Other things that have gone on in 2020 that is in the rearview mirror, but is not that, it's still closer than it appears. The economy has shut down. We are experiencing that. Many small businesses have closed their doors for good because of what's going on. There is a lot of suffering happening. Many have lost their homes. Many have lost their jobs, so they're unable to keep their homes. Homelessness has exploded worldwide and in this nation. Homelessness has always been here, and it's always been kind of a struggle to get it under control. But now it has exploded even more with everything that has happened and going on. But we are to still keep our hearts and minds focused on the Lord. We are to seek Him and ask Him, not just for our lives, but for everyone else in this world, those who do know and those who do not know Him. To please, Lord, let Your grace and mercy be mightily be upon them. Help their suffering, and may they come and turn and look to You. We have political unrest. Just turn on your TV and radio. Right about now, none of us want to turn on our TV or radio and all the chaos that's going on out there. But if you do, and when you do, you will hear, like, you'd say to yourself, are we living in the Middle East where there's just so much unrest and you see all these acts of violence happening? And so many people are caught off guard. Many Christians, we have friends who serve and love the Lord, and even they are finding themselves blindsided by this. But the Lord told us that these days are going to come, and that we should not be caught off guard when they do come. And they are coming. We are in the last days. Things are progressively getting worse and worse. Now, many don't like to admit that. Many do. But we know in order for Christ to come and institute His kingdom, things have to get worse. Scripture tells us that. I'm not telling you that. Scripture is telling us that. And we are to be looking unto the Lord more and more. We are to be making sure our hearts and minds are grounded in His word and in prayer and encouraging all those around us, especially the brethren first. But those who do not know the Lord, we are to be encouraging them that this is not going to last, and that we are praying and asking, come, Lord Jesus, come. We look at a lot of the churches across this nation. Many have closed their doors and are now holding services online. That's a good thing, because they are looking out for the well-being of their brethren, and it's still getting God's word out there. Yes, many of them have been online already for years. CBF, we have recently just done that. So we are able to be out there online, spreading our message and giving hope and peace and encouragement to everyone. Some have remained open. To what degree, I'm not exactly sure, but some have. But the fact is that many churches have closed and now they're online. Will these churches reopen? We don't know if these churches will reopen. We don't know if they'll stay to the point where they are online. Either way, things are not going to be as they were. There's a common theme that I've been hearing from many friends and family is that they desire for things to go back to the way they were before 2020. Now, from a fleshly point of view, I understand that. But from a spiritual point of view, we are not to be desiring and looking backwards. Ecclesiastes 7, 8 to 10 says, "The end of a thing is better than its beginning. The patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. Do not hasten in your spirit to be angry, for anger rests in the bosom of fools. Do not say, why were the former days better than these? For you do not inquire wisely concerning this. Let us not look backwards. Now, looking backwards to learn is one thing, but the warnings that Scripture tell us is to be looking back to desire. Jesus says in Luke 9, chapter 9, verse 62, but Jesus said to him, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. So what is the Lord saying? That if you're moving forward, you're plowing the ground, you're growing in him, we can't glance backwards at all? No. But to look backwards is to desire what's behind. We're to be looking forward. I remember Andrew said to us once, because he grew up on a farm, and when he was a young lad, his dad told him to go out and hill a row of potatoes. And he did exactly just this one thing. He looked back, and in that quick second, he said he plowed up a half a row of potatoes. Because not staying focused forward, he went off track. So yes, we are to make sure we stay looking forward so we don't go off track. But we're not to be looking back to the point of desiring. Genesis 19:17, talking about Lot. So in chapter 19, verse 17, so it came to pass when they had brought them outside that he said, escape for your life. Do not look behind you, nor stay anywhere in the plain. Escape to the mountains, lest you be destroyed. This is the angel speaking to Lot on taking his family. Genesis 23, to verses 23 to 26, same chapter 19. The sun had risen upon the earth when Lot entered Zoar. Then the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah, from the Lord out of heavens. So he overthrew those cities, all the plain, all the inhabitants of the cities, and what grew in the ground. But his wife looked back behind him, and she became a pillar of salt. Now we know that when we read about the Lot in this encounter, that his wife did not want to leave. She desired and she loved and enjoyed everything about Sodom and Gomorrah. So her looking back was out of desire, not out of curiosity. And her heart was back there, not forward with the Lord. We got to be careful that we do not have our heart looking backwards. We need to be looking forwards. And in doing that, we have to make sure that we are constantly in his word. We are in prayer. We are seeking him daily. Even though we might not be meeting in churches, we can still call up our brethren. We can call them on the phone. We can have conversations. We can have encouragements over text. You can go ahead and do emails. We are to be encouraging each other during this time. We are not so cut off that everything is lost. Everything is not lost. Things are progressing towards the day of the Lord coming. And that is what we who live for the Lord Jesus Christ are to be desiring for. We are not to be looking backwards. We're not to be desiring the way things were before 2020 and COVID-19. But we are to adapt. We can change. These things are lessons that can help us grow and mature. Things can be better. Yes, has there been great loss? But we still can also have great gains. But those great gains have to come by us looking forward. So you might be asking yourself, so where do we go from here, Brother Steve, then? Well, pressing forward, as it states in Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. This is from Brother Paul. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. I press toward the goal of for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. We are to be pressing forward. We are not to be looking behind. Let us learn from the things that have happened, but let us not learn to the point of forgetting, but let us learn to the point where we apply it to our lives. We need to apply the things that have happened. There is many great things that are coming out of this. A lot of people might be, what are you talking about, great things, Steve? Look at everything around you. Maybe you do need to turn on your radio or your TV. I'm not talking about in this world. I'm talking about spiritually. Many people are seeking the Lord. Many more people are on bended knee asking God for His grace and mercy. That is a good thing. You, hopefully, are on your knees more praying and asking the Lord for His mercy, guidance, and direction. I know Faye and I are always praying, Lord, help us be that godly example to everyone we come across. Are we successful all the time? No, we're not. We do our best, but we are constantly praying without ceasing, just as Apostle Paul tells us to. And in pressing forward, speaking of myself, I'm going to take this time to bring forth some personal comments, some things that I've seen, I've experienced over the years, and in pressing forward and everything that has happened with COVID-19, and where we go from here. Churches and brotherly love, where would I like us to see us going forward? Going forward, again, this is my own personal finding, where has the respect for brotherly love and the brethren gone? Whoa, what do you mean by that, Steve? You just got done saying that we're praying for each other, speaking to each other, and all those good things. Yes, I am saying that. But in my life and in my struggles, one thing that I have noticed that have gone on is that before COVID-19, people did not stop coming to church sick. People would show up being sick when they shouldn't be here, and a lot of times not even telling the other brethren that they are sick until after they've hugged them, shaken hands, or spent some time in close proximity talking with them. Then they come out and say, oh, by the way, I'm sick, I'm fighting the flu. These are the things I'd like to see change. I mean, look at where we are right now. People will go nowhere if they don't feel themselves. They're staying home. But this is being done out of fear. Is it also respect that they don't want to sit there and take the chance that they might have COVID and spread it? Yes. But a sad statement is the fact that with the church being closed and myself not being here as much throughout the year, before we went online, we'd still go ahead and get CDs to hear. And then when we transferred over to online, we'd watch them from home. Because I have a compromised immune system, and I get sick very easy. But the sad statement is, as bad as COVID-19 has been in the 2020 year, it's been my healthiest year because I have not been coming to church and I have not been going out being around people who felt it was okay to be around you when they were sick and not tell you. This is a real huge thing for me because in the years past, I was sick quite often. When I get sick, it takes me sometimes 2 weeks to up to 2 months to get back to where I need to be. A lot of times it's not worth the risk. And being out of church, and the fact that there are people who are taking it more serious not to be around when they're sick, has helped this be my healthiest year. And it's not just this church. We have friends and family who attend churches all over the country that I've talked to, and they voice the same concern. Many of them are staying home watching online because the risk for them is not worth it going to church, because people show up sick, not knowing if they have COVID. And unfortunately, COVID is the one thing that is driving this, when it should have been, I'm not feeling good, I'm not going to go to church, I'm not going to get my brethren sick. And many of them, even before this, have not been going to church. We should not have to feel like we are rolling the dice on whether we should go to church or not, due to the leaders and brethren who decide on coming to church sick. All of us need to have the love of the brethren in their hearts and minds to say, stay home when they are sick. I'm not saying that you sit there and you tell people, do not come. You cannot control them and you cannot force them. But especially the leaders of the church need to set the example that it's not okay. Well, that's kind of hard to do. Well, is it? Look at what's going on right now. It should not have had to come down to a pandemic and regulations from the government for us to take this issue seriously. To recap, let us not be focused on the things behind us, but through the Spirit of Christ, learn from them. Let us move forward and let us learn from the things that are happening. Let us sit there and have the respect that even if you do decide when things reopen again, if things reopen to the degree it was, if you do decide to go to church sick, stay away from people. Let them know immediately, I don't feel good, please. And, you know, sit somewhere else in the church. Don't sit there and just keep it to yourself and wait until five people have hugged you or shook in your hands. And then you say, oh, by the way, I'm fighting the flu. That's happened to me more than I can count. And it is a sad thing for times where being a member of this church, being a deacon, that there's times where I had to sit there and decide, is it worth me going to church? I have a lot of stuff I have to do to take care of around the house. I don't need to get sick because someone decided to show up to church and then all of a sudden I'm down and out for 2 months. We need to have the respect and the love for the brethren. And in doing this, we need to move forward. We learn from the things that we are going through and we apply them to our lives. We sit there and ask the Lord to help us, show us, encourage us, and teach us. Now, in doing this, we cannot, again, be looking backwards. And even with everything that's going on in the world, we also need to focus on and be in control of our emotions, that we do not be entangled with the current affairs. But let us hold firm to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us fix our eyes upward and forward for Christ's kingdom. For that is what we should be looking for. And as we look forward to, you know, Christ's kingdom, we take the events that are going on. We look at them. We acknowledge them, but we don't get entangled with them. We don't sit there and spend our time looking backwards. And we learn from them. You know, as I was mentioning that about, you know, people being sick at church, it's almost comical, but it's very sad at the same time. And where I'm going with this is that this last week, when I was walking around Home Depot, they were putting an announcement out over the speakers. If you're going to cough, please cough into your elbow. Do not cough into the air or into your hand. If you are sick, please go ahead and do not come into the store. If you have children who are going to cough, please teach them and have them cough into their elbow. Seriously? We need to be told these things? When I was growing up, it was bred into us that you coughed into your elbow. Going to school, be like, hey, where's Jimmy? Well, Jimmy's not feeling good. He's at home. You know, he's not coming in today because he's not feeling good. Where is all the common sense gone to where we are just now being like, oh, we got to change these things. Well, why did those things even get lost? We should never have lost that factor that you sit there and you're going to cough or sneeze. You do it into your elbow. Before COVID-19 happened, because of my, you know, highly, you know, compromised immune system, I would still wear a mask into a store. Because, oh my gosh, the people I used to see just coughing as they're looking into the freezers and what they want, just coughing all over the door. Kids coughing and sneezing all over carts and all over food that they picked up and they put back because they don't want it anymore. Oh my gosh. I mean, it was awful. I didn't even want to go shopping because of that. But now you walk around the stores and they now have to tell you to do this? Come on, let us be of sound mind. Let us make sure that we are pressing forward, not just in everything in our lives, but closer to Christ, and also learning and making sure we do the things we need to do. We do not need to be entangled or go backwards. Let us move forwards. Let us learn from these things and apply them. And there is a warning. 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 20 through 22, gives us a warning of what happens if you do not keep pressing forward and you find yourself getting entangled with the things around you. 2 Peter chapter 2, 20 through 22. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. For it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it to turn from the holy commandments delivered to them. But it has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to its own vomit, and a sow having washed to her wallowing in the mire. Wow. That's pretty big sitting there saying that those of us who call on the Lord Jesus Christ, if we find ourselves being entangled with the affairs of the world, focusing more on the things of the world, we are in danger of becoming a dog who returns to its vomit or a sow wanting to return to the wallowing in the mire. We are not to desire the things of the past. We are to be desiring the things of Christ and the forward thinking that Christ is coming. We are to hasten the day of Christ's return by us seeking him and praying and asking daily, come Lord Jesus, come. The other night I was talking to a longtime friend of the family. She loves the Lord. Her and her husband love the Lord immensely. But unfortunately, they have bought in and believe that we have an immortal soul and that of hell and damnation. And if you don't accept Christ in this age, that you're lost. And she's all worried for her family. And I said, that's not the God we serve. I said, we do not have an immortal soul. God alone has immortality. And that was given unto Christ upon his resurrection. When we all die, we go into the grave, as it states in Genesis, from the curse of the fall of Adam and Eve. We are all in the graves waiting for that resurrection from Christ. Those who have done good to a resurrection of life, the bride of Christ. Those who have done evil to a resurrection of judgment to reconciliation, to have an opportunity to come and accept and know Jesus. They are not lost. And why am I saying that? Because that friend was saying to me, I do desire the Lord to come, but I'm not going to pray that right now because I'm worried for friends and family who have not accepted Christ. We need to be really seeking God's word and asking the Spirit to reveal things to us. They are not lost. And we need to be praying, come, Lord Jesus, come. Let us hasten the day of the coming of the Lord by us seeking him, by us on our knees and learning and growing and becoming that spiritual person we are supposed to be that encouragement to our friends and our family and our children and our grandchildren and everyone around us. We need to have that respect for our friends and our family and our brethren. Faye and I have that with a lot of our friends when if we hold cookouts. We've had a bonfire on New Year's Eve. We only had a couple over. But the people we invite are the ones that we know will be 100% truthful with us, that they have not been around anyone, and that even if they have a sniffle or they think it's an allergy, that they will not come. We have a close-knit group that we trust wholeheartedly. But it's pretty sad when you don't feel that way about going to church, because people are going to come and then you have to worry about becoming sick. And then all of a sudden you're down and out for weeks to a couple months. So let us press forward and let us look unto Christ. Let us not also be caught up into all the things going on around us. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verses 4 and 5 says this: no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. God's word is our rule book. That is what we are to follow. We are to be focused on Christ, focused forward, which means we are always growing and maturing. Doesn't mean we're sitting there holding an anvil over someone's head that if they don't do it. But we need to not focus on the past. We need to learn from the past. We need to learn from the present. And we need to grow and move forward and not be intimidated on who we might offend. Instead of that, we should have the attitude of, who am I going to inspire today? With that, I'd like to close with, may the Lord Jesus bless you this day, and may he fill you with his Spirit. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, I come before you and I thank you for this day. I thank you for this opportunity to come before everyone to speak what you've placed upon my heart. I ask that, again, you open the spiritual hearts and minds of everyone to receive what it is that you have given me to speak on this day. And I do pray and ask, Lord, that we do seek you, that we do worry more about who we are going to inspire and less about who we're going to offend. So help us, Lord Jesus, be focused on you and guide us and direct us. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Jesus, you can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I am alone, Jesus, give me Jesus. And when I come to doubt, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. You can have all this world. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus.